My name is Leonis Joseph Ndolagi, Assistant Lecturer from the Faculty of Business Management. And today we are going to learn on the subject known as OAF 112, and this is Business Mathematics and Statistics. Now, lecture one is the set theorem, and this is belonging to the knowledge area one. And into this lecture, after learning this lecture, you should be able to acquire about five knowledge, and this knowledge are: you'll be able to explain what sets are and different ways of describing them, define and explain the basic concept underlying the set theory, define and perform various operations with the set, identify and use different laws of set operation to show relationship among sets, together with the way on how to draw diagram to show the relationship among sets. The first part of this topic is to define a set itself. We say set is described as a collection or a group of things. For instance, a pile of books, a collection of trees, a swarm of bees, a flock of sheep. These are the examples of collected things and what we call set. Set is noted by a kind of brackets as shown on the board, and is named by the capital letter, while its member to that set is always being written by using small letters. For instance, if you have set A that may contain maybe four elements. Now this is A, B, C, and D. We read it as A is a set of A, B, C, D. And now we say, when you say collected things, sometimes when you have two things collected together, these are what we call pair. And when you have 12 things collected together, these we call it dozen. When you have 144 things collected together, we call it gross. While when you have 500 items or things collected together, we call it as a ring. And the number of elements in a set can also be noted by N in the brackets, capital A, meaning that this shows the number of elements within that set. And this is what we call cardinality of the set. When you have the symbol like this one, this is the symbol that indicates the membership of the element within the set. And when the element is not belonging to that set, we give a symbol like that one, then you cut as it is kept there. And this is simply given as the element which does not belong into that set. For instance, if you have set A and the members are A, E, I, O, and U, if you count them all, you end up getting five elements. These five elements are what we call the number of elements within the set, and this cardinal is what we call the number of elements within that set. And sometimes, when you learn set, you are supposed to be aware on how we call and how you can list the numbers of different type. When you have number like 2, 4, 6, and 8 continuously of such kind of series, we call it as even number. And the odd numbers are listed as from 1, 3, 5, 7, and so on. While prime numbers, we list them as starting with 2, 3, 5, 7, and so on. Whole numbers are written starting from 0, 1, 2, 3, and so on. While counting number or natural numbers, we add them by using 1, 2, 3, and so on. Integer numbers, or what we call real numbers, we wrote it like negative 1 continuously to the left and the negative 2, negative 1, 0, 1, 2, 3 continuously. And the rational number is also written by having just a fraction 1 over 2, 5 over 5, 6 over 5. And the irrational numbers are the numbers of which the root of it, it doesn't end, like the root of 2, the root of 3, and the root of 5. The third part is the set description and its type. The first description of the set is known as how you can describe a set by weight. The second type is by describing the set by listing. Again, you can describe the set by formula. If you say you describe a set by weight, it's like when you have A is a set of even numbers. Now, if we describe the set by listing, you will have to list them like A is 2, 4, 6, 8, and so on. And now, if we describe the set as by formula, you have to explain and say A is a set of x such that x equals to twice n, whereby n will have to be a number like 1, 2, 3, 4, and so on. Now, the types of set itself are field set, of which now the field set, these are the set of which its element can be counted or listed exhaustively. For instance, if we have set A that contain elements like 2, 4, 6, up to 24, then we have to say this is a field set. Or else you can have the set Q that contain elements like 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Here you count them exhaustively, and this is what we call field number or field number of a set. Now, in field set, we say these are the set of which all its elements cannot be counted or listed exhaustively. For instance, if you have set B of which is equal to number 2, number 4, 6 continuously, we say these have not been counted its element exhaustively. So it is infinity set. While the empty set, this is the set that have got no element at all. And for example, a set of prime numbers between 31 and 37 is an empty set, simply because there is no prime numbers between 31 and 37. The other part is the way you can compare these sets. We say when two sets or more are compared, may be found that the sets can be equivalent, or one set can be the subset of the other, or these sets can be equal. Now, for a set which are equivalent, these are the set whose element or members match exactly. For instance, if we have set A equals to element that were 2, 4, and 6, and the other element, the other set B with element A, B, C. Then we say set A and set B are equivalent. Are equivalent is not in what way? It's because the number of elements in set A are the same as the number of elements in set B. Why? Equal set, these are the sets that contain the same element of which all the sets available have equal and same element. For instance, if you have set A with elements 2, 4, and 6, and you have set B with elements 4, 2, and 6, these are two different sets, but all the elements within this set are the same and are equal numbers. The other type of set are the subsets, and we say when two types of sets like set A with the element 1, 3, 4, 9, and 8, and set B with 3, 4, and 9 are put together, we say set B has element of which all the elements belong to set A. Now we call this set B as proper subset of set A. That is proper subset of set A. The other type of subset is improper subset. Now improper subset, these are the sets of which all elements in those two sets or three sets written are the same. For instance, if you have set A with 1, 3, 4, 8, and 9, and set B with 1, 3, 4, 8, and 9, these two sets have equal number of elements, they also have the same number of elements. So we say these are improper sets because set A can be called as the subset of set B, and also set B can be called as the subset of set A. Now the other part, it is the number of subsets within the set itself. And to find out the number of subsets within the set, we can use the formula as 2 exponent n, whereby, how do we get 2 exponent n? We can use an example of a set W that has element A, B, C. Now we can see there we have 3 elements. Now we say empty set is also the subset of set W. Now if we can count again other subsets, we say set A, element A is also the subset of set W. Again, you can have A and B, which is also the subset of set W. Again, you can have A, B, and C as the subset of set W. The 3 subsets of tails can also be written in a numerical way, like when we said empty set is also the subset of set W, it means we have 2 exponent n, and n now is 0, so 2 exponent 0, it becomes equals to 1. And when you said A, element A is not a subset of set W, then we say if you put n is equal to 1, you will have 2 exponent 1 equals to 2. Again, we have elements which are A, B, C, and the A, B, C will be three elements, and the three elements, N will be equal to 3. Now, when you put 2, exponent 3, the answer will become what? 8. Now, as you can see, the consistent there, when you have no element, that you have empty set, being the subset of set W, 2 exponent 0, again, you have one element, 2 exponent 1, you have two element, 2 exponent 2, you have three element, 2 exponent 3, then the general formula, that's why it becomes now 2 exponent n as the general formula to obtain n of the number of elements within the set. The other part is now how to allocate or to write a set by using the Venn diagram. The set can also be creation by drawing code as the Venn diagram. The Venn diagram are named after John Venn. He's an English mathematician who devised them. And this is, for instance, if you have set A equals to set of element A, B, C, this can also be represented by using the Venn diagram, of which it contains overlaid structure, as it is kept there, and this comprises an overstructure with its element A, B, and C, and sometimes it might happen these overlap each other. When they overlap, we call it as joint sets. We call it a joint sets. And when they don't overlap, it means they separate each element alone. We call it as disjoint set. Another part, it is how to operate set. We call it set operation. And basically, we have three set operation. And the first one is the intersection of sets. The intersection of sets, when you have two or three or four sets, and it happens that some of the element appears in two, both or three sets, we say the element that appear in both sets, they are being intersected. For instance, if you have set A that contains element 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5, and set B with 2, 4, 6, 8, and 10. Now we say A intersection B is equal to a set of 2 and 4. The element 2 and 4 are the only element that contained in both set A and set B. Then the first kind of how to operate the set. The second is to operate the set by using union. The union of the sets is the new set formed when members of all the sets available are put or written together without repetition. The symbol used to denote the union or combination of the sets is that one. For example, given that set A contains elements 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6, and set B contains 1, 2, 3, 4, 6, 8, and 10, then A union B will be the union or a written by taking all the elements in set A and all elements in set B, but without repetition. The set operation of the set is the universal set. The universal set is the general set from which elements of all other sets under consideration are drawn. As seen there, we have set A, we have set B, and the universe is outside the rectangle. It means this do contain all elements of the two sets available, that is element of set A and element of set B, together with all elements within that square. It's like how it is there. Set A is containing A, B, C, D, E and F. Again, set B will have to contain E, F, G, H, I, J. Again, we have elements which are outside the two sets, that is element N, M, L and K. When these all elements are written together without repeating any of the elements, we call this set that contains all elements as the universal set. So when you operate the two sets, you will have to use one of the formula. This is given as number of A. If you have two sets, for instance, set A and set B, you will have set number of set A, you add with number of set B, you less the number of set A intersection B, this will be equal to the number of A union B. And if we are operating now three sets, this formula will a little bit extend, and we have the number of elements in set A, you add with number of elements in set B, plus the number of elements in set C, less the number of elements in set A intersection B, less number of elements in set A intersection C, less number of elements in set B intersection C. Again, you add back the number of elements in set A intersection B intersection C, will be equal to the number of elements set A union B union C at the second formula when you operate three sets. The other part is now how to use laws in the set operation. Sometimes we may have a more complex set operations. The evaluation exercise can be made easier using law of set operation, which will be explained here below. And we have about 8 law of set operation. The first one is a commutative law, where you have the two sets, for example here, which is an example, set A together with the set B. If you have A union B, this can be equals to B union A. Or if you have A intersection B, this will be equals to B intersection A. This is what we call commutative law. It is just an interchange of the position of the two sets. And the second is associative law, whereby when you have three sets and you have to operate them with changing the brackets from the two sets within the three sets. Like when you have A union in brackets, B union C, this the answer will be equals to A union B in brackets, again union C. Or you may have A intersection brackets, B intersection C, equals to A intersection B in brackets intersection C. The third one, it is distributive law, where you have the three sets, but you are using now the two set operations. You are using union together with the intersection. For instance, if you have A union B intersection C, the B intersection C being in brackets, this will be the same as A union B in brackets intersection A union C in brackets. Again, you can have A intersection B in bracket with union C. This will be the same as A intersection B in brackets union A intersection C. These two is what we call distributive law. And the independent law, this is when you have A union A the same as A, or you can have B intersection B the same as B, or you can have D intersection D the same as D. This is what we call the law of that one. And the identity law in the fifth one is when now you operate A universal set, you end up on having universal law. And when you have B intersection universe, you end up with having B. And when you have A, you don't empty set, you get A. B intersection empty set, you get empty set. These four are also known as identity law. And the last one, B intersection empty set equals to empty set, is also termed as empty set law. Why the first one? A universal, this is also termed as universal law because we end up on having universal itself. The sixth is the Bogen law, where you have A B in bracket complement, you end up having A complement intersection B complement, and you can have A intersection B in bracket complement. This is the same as A complement union B complement. The seventh one is complement law. When you have the complement of the empty set, you get universal. Or you have the complement of the universal, you get empty set. Or given set A complement, again complement, that gives you the same set, set A for that example. And D is when you have a set union its complement, you end up on having universal. When you have a set again intersection complement of the same set, you get empty set. This is complement law. The last one is absorber law, where again you operate two sets, but also you have two operations of the set. It's like when you have A union A intersection B, you end up on having A. When you have A intersection A union B, you end up on having A. For instance, on how to operate this law of set operations is like when you have the questions that is asking you simplify the following set operations: A intersection A union B in bracket complement with other bracket complement again, where A and B are non-empty set. We said you have to open these elements by the use of the law that have been explained before. And we start opening this set by the Bogen law, whereby the time you had A union B being in brackets complement, this can be simplified and made it as A complement intersection B complement. This is simplified by the Bogen law. And now you can change the bracket from A intersection A complement, intersection B complement, to A intersection A complement in bracket. Again, you leave the B complement as without brackets. And now, this is what we call when you change the brackets from one set to another set, we say this is by associative law. And now, this can also be operated again. How operated now? It is A intersection A complement. This can be made simple and become empty set by complement law. Again, if you take empty set intersection any set, you end up getting the same set. This is by what we call empty set law. And now at the end, we have empty set complement. The complement of empty set is universal by empty set law. Then the first example. The second example is when you have, again, to make it simple by having a complex equation like that one, and we have A intersection B, intersection C again, now we have three sets, and in brackets, you learn with A intersection B intersection C, bracket, again, you learn B complement, you learn C complement, bracket. Now, to make it simple, you need to revisit all of the eight laws, and as you can see there, number of the sets available are three, and now you have A intersection B intersection C, again you have A intersection B intersection C, almost the same. Now we can take one of them. How do we take one of them? Because A intersection B intersection C union with A intersection B intersection C will be the same as A intersection B intersection C by an independent law. That is already very simple. Now we can continue to simplify it more by using the other law. This law now, which can make it simple because of having the B complement, you will see complement, is the Morgan law, whereby we have A intersection B, as we can see, union A intersection C in the bracket with the complement and the top. And now, by using associative law, we have to change the brackets to make it more simple. And now, B intersection C will come together and make a union with B intersection C complement, while leaving A intersection A outside the big bracket. And this is by associative law. To make it simple again, the B intersection C and B intersection C complement can be simplified more, and this becomes universal set because of the law, what we call complement law. And now we can end up on having A intersection universal, the answer of which it is A. This is by identity law. The last part of on how to operate these sets is now the application of it. When you are operating set, what is the application of it? We say a set theory are very useful in solving a problem like the survey problem, especially when the problem involves the analysis of data or the individual variables which are overlapping. That's the first application of having the knowledge on set theory. The other application of this set theory, it is that the idea of Venn diagram that I've introduced into this lecture is considerably very important because it reduces the complexity of the limited and the small numbers of the sets that would have been complex as if we could have been not using sets. Otherwise, the class, we have to do some activity. We have two activities that compares on how we are supposed to simplify the set operations, and the other one to make sure that you can be able to draw the Venn diagram and find out the number of elements within that set. The last part, you have to visit some references, and here we have three references. Very basic one, you have to go through L.P. Francis. This is Business Mathematical Statistics book, a sixth edition, and this will help you to cover some of the other additive notes to help you to understand more on how to solve several questions concerning set theorem. And thank you for listening. God bless you. End of lecture one.